So despite all the changes that has been made to the Lumberjacks roster, and they have made a ton of them, this club continues to just fall short. A lot of guys who want to be a Lumberjack, leaping from tree to tree as they float down the mighty rivers of British Columbia, the giant redwood, the larch, the fir, the mighty Scots pine, the lofty flowering cherry, the plucky little aspen, the limping rue tree of Nigeria, the towering wattle of Aldershot, the maidenhead weeping water plant, the naughty Leicestershire flashing oak, the flatulent elm of West Ruislip. I'm quoting, of course, the Lumberjack song made famous by Monty Python. On that note, I think we better turn it over to Josh Maurer. Have a fantastic night, Josh. It's all yours.
What? What was that? All right, Larry. Thank you very much, I think.
Taking 3 out of 4 from the Lumberjacks pretty much knocked Bangor out of the race. Not mathematically eliminated, but realistically, they were toast. The Rox were now in a tight three-way battle with first-half champion North Shore and Quebec, the team that they would be hosting next at Campanelli Stadium. And that meant the return of a very popular player to Brockton.
Now it is Steve Booker coming to the plate, the former Brockton Rox player, 2 for 3 since joining the Quebec Capitals. First pitch to the right-hander Booker is in there for a called strike. Talked to Steve prior to the ball game. He said it was pretty exciting to be back here at Campanelli Stadium, and yes, it felt just a bit odd being in the visiting dugout. 0-2 pitch. Swung on, ground ball right side, diving stop by Craig Lewis, and there's going to be no play because Booker is so fast that he gets to first base way before Scott Martin does. And Quebec has taken a 4-0 lead.
The Rox had opened the season with outfielders Ben Johnstone and Willie Edwards on their roster. For some reason, Ed didn't seem to like Johnstone, who was released after only one game. Edwards was given plenty of time, but never found the stroke he displayed the previous season in the Frontier League, where he'd hit .314. In his 30 games with Brockton, he managed only a .181 batting average. They were replaced by a couple high-quality kids, Junior Medina, who had hit a ton of home runs for nearby Stonehill College, and Abner Arroyo, a left-handed hitter who had spent a few years in the San Diego Padres organization. Now, Booker probably couldn't match Medina or Arroyo in the power-hitting department, but he was a far superior defensive player, covered much more territory, and had a stronger, more accurate arm, was a better contact hitter, a better base runner, base stealer. In fact, he was considered the fastest runner on the team when he was with the Rox. So many figured that it was a given that the Rox would re-sign him once he recovered from his groin injury, much the same as they had done with Mike Davis. Their decision not to re-sign Booker was simply baffling. And then to make matters worse, Steve signed with Quebec, where he would make a huge contribution down the stretch, including going 2 for 3 with an RBI and a sacrifice bunt in the opening game of that three-game series against Brockton, helping Les Capitals to a 7-2 win. That game was an uncharacteristically rough start for Scott Martin, who was roughed up for 6 innings before finally being relieved in the 7th inning by Greg Salvivold, the veteran pitcher who had been signed to replace Rodney Allen.
On the hill right now is the newest member of the Brockton Rox, Greg Salvivold, right-handed pitcher. Salvivold, 6'3", 180-pounder. The Rox fans that are braving out the weather tonight, giving him a warm welcome. Spent quite a few years with Fargo Moorhead, actually starting to pitch with them back in 1997. Look at the win-loss records by Salvivold, and they're pretty impressive. 10-1 back in 1999, 9-4 in 2000, 8-7 in 2001, and 9-5 last year. ERA's a little high, though. Last year, 3.96, 4.91 the year prior to that, and over 5 in 2000. Payoff pitch on the way to Bordenica, a swing and a miss. to a mighty fine start for Greg Salvebold in his first appearance in a Rox uniform. It's a 1-2-3 inning.
Salvebold allowed only one hit in three innings, but the loss meant the Rox desperately needed to win the final two games of this series, and they rose to the occasion.
Off-speed pitch misses up high, and Mr. Smith takes the base on balls on four pitches. That is not how Dunn wanted to start this ball game. 1-1 pitch with the runner going. Pitch is in there for a strike, but Letalian can't get the handle on the ball, and Smith is in with a stolen base without a throw to second base. His 13th steal of the season, tying him for the team lead with Saul Bustos. 1-2 pitch. Misses down low, bounces away from Letalian, and that will allow Smith to advance to third base. The 1-0 offering from Dunn. Line drive into right field. Base hit Bustos. That will score Smith, and the Rox have taken a 1-0 lead. Saul Bustos with a single that deflates Smith for the first run of the ball game. The sumo wrestlers are at it in between inning promotion here at Campanelli Stadium. Larry Blucher, Ryan Smith back with you. The Rox leading Quebec 3-1. And they're having a good time with the sumo guys again, aren't they, Ryan? It's great to see when they have a little bit of an attitude out there and they're actually duking it out. Last night, it was more of a love fest. Tonight, at least, they went at each other and there was some great oohs and ahs from the crowd. A guy who provides some oohs and ahs during batting practice usually is Craig Lewis. He is 1-for-1 with a double and a sacrifice fly, capable of hitting the ball a long way. And the first pitch to the right-hander is hit a long way to left field. A mole back, looks up, and the ball is out of here. A home run for Craig Lewis. It is 4-1 Rox.
The Rox won that game by a score of 4-2. Joey Baker and Connor Brooks combining on a six-hitter. And then Mike Marcusano pitched a four-hit complete game as Brockton won the finale by a score of 2-1. Prior to that game, I was in the Rox locker room, and the only other guy in there was Marcusano, who was starting that night. I had come to a stop, and Mike followed my gaze to Chad Ward's locker, which was empty. Mike looked sick. He said to me, "You have got to be kidding." It wasn't a joke. Ed had told Chad that he was going to a four-man rotation for the rest of the season. And even though Chad had pitched extremely well for more than the last month, Ed told him he was the odd man out, that he might get another start or two, but he would work primarily out of the bullpen. Chad told me that Ed did not sugarcoat the news, surprise, surprise, and that he had taken Ed's shit for too long and he was sick of it. Now, I've talked about their rocky relationship, and sure enough, Chad told Ed that he wanted his release. He cleaned out his locker and left. The next day, the struggling Allentown Ambassadors came to Campanelli Stadium. Their starting pitcher, Chris Kelly, had an earned run average of higher than 7. Looked like a mismatch for the hard-hitting Rox. But when Kelly took a no-hitter into the 7th inning, I felt I owed it to my listeners to question whether this might be fallout from the Chad Ward situation.
Hitting was not a problem for the last month. These guys have really been going to town at the plate. I wonder if the whole Ward thing hasn't been a distraction for these players. Chad Ward did get off to a slow start this year, but really had righted himself and had been, outside of Mike Marcusano, the Rox's best pitcher over the last couple of months. So it came completely out of right field when Ed Nottle said that he was going to go with a four-man rotation that would not include Chad Ward. Every single guy I talked to expressed disbelief. Most of them were saying that this would be a move that would cost the Rox. So just maybe that has served as a bit of a distraction. You can't blame the whole thing on that, obviously. Chris Kelly's pitching a very good ball game tonight, but surprised it's quite this good. Now, if you listen to the pregame interview that Josh Maurer did with Ed Nottle about the situation, Ed said part of his problem with Chad was that he arrived out of shape. And the question then becomes, why not release him early in the season when he was struggling? I don't think anybody would have been surprised if Chad Ward had been released after three starts. Because I agree with that. He did come in here out of shape, but he struggled out of the gates. The question is, why give up on a guy when he has really hit stride? Five of the last 7 games, he'd gone 7 or more innings. And Chad Ward has a proven history of being his strongest in August. And his catcher, Mel Rosario, a couple of nights ago, who was the one pitcher on the staff that he would want on the mound in an important ball game without even hesitating. He said Chad Ward. And the worst part, I guess, of the whole thing, then, is that not only are you letting Ward go, but now it appears that they will get absolutely nothing in return. They won't even be able to trade him away.
The Rox did break up Chris Kelly's no-hit bid in the eighth inning, but lost the game 4-1. Now Brockton had also lost, in addition to Ward, their big slugger, Jermaine Swinton, talented rookie outfielder Steve Booker, and another ace pitcher, Rodney Allen. Would the team be able to overcome those losses during the season's final weeks? Be sure to click the subscribe button to follow my wild and wacky journey with the Brockton Rox, because more episodes are on the way. Thanks for watching.